we'll be talking to our very special guest about investing in international funds, how do it, what role do mutual funds play in it, and how can it perhaps enhance an individual's mutual fund portfolios. To chat about all this and more, let me invite on board Mr. Hemant Rustagi. He's joining us right now to talk about all of that, which I just flagged off, and more about investing. Mr. Rustagi, thank you so much. It was a pleasure getting you on the show today. First up, I want to understand, talk to us about your view on investing outside the markets in India. Why should one do it? What addition does it make to anybody's portfolio?
Well, you know, when we talk about investing, especially any kind of investor, you know, the level of diversification in the portfolio plays a very key role in the kind of investment success you'll achieve over a period of time. So when we talk about diversification, you know, usually what investors do is they invest across different asset classes. For example, you know, the money is invested in equity, long-term money goes into equity, then there is debt, and there's also gold in the portfolio. Now, when we talk about international investing, I think that adds totally new different dimension to the, you know, diversification level in the portfolio. See, typically what happens when you talk about a global market, even though we consider, you know, the entire world to be one market, but I think there are a number of ways where we can say that the international markets are still uncorrelated with each other. Now, for example, when you invest in international markets, you get to invest in an economy which may have a very low fiscal deficit, or the current account, you know, will be surplus, which may not be the case in our domestic economy. So clearly, if you want to achieve the right level of diversification, or the diversification in the true sense, I think international investing plays a key role there.
It definitely adds to diversity as far as your portfolio and the host of asset classes are concerned. But how can somebody use their mutual funds to invest in international market? I mean, how does that play out, if you could explain for our viewers?
Well, you know, while we just discussed about how important it is for any investor to invest in international markets, it can be quite tricky for someone who is not aware of how to invest in international markets. So clearly, I think mutual fund play a very key role there. There are three different ways through which one can invest in international market using mutual funds. One, you know, there are fund of funds. Now, you basically have a feeder fund. So whenever a mutual fund is launching a fund of fund, which is a feeder fund, you can invest in that. And that feeder fund will invest in a target fund, which may be an international fund. Now, which means that if there is a fund which is based in US, maybe investing in US markets. So there are country-specific funds, for example, investing in US markets. There are funds investing in, let's say, China or Brazil. There are funds which invest in regions, for example, emerging markets. There are also funds which invest in commodities or agribusinesses. So there are a wide variety of fund of funds which are available for any investor who wants to invest in international markets. Second, there are funds which invest directly. For example, there are funds which invest directly into US stocks, which is again different from investing in a fund of fund. Third category of fund through which one can invest in international market is the fund which invests 65% or more in domestic market, and 35% around is invested in the international market. So this is the third category, can be again a great option for someone who cannot decide, you know, how much to invest in international markets. So there are three different types of products which are available for any domestic investor who want to invest in international markets.
So when the options are so many, when the choices are so varied, how does one choose what's right for them? How to choose an international fund that works for an individual?
Well, I think once one realizes the importance of adding international funds to the portfolio, especially from the diversification point of view, then the next question is, how much should be invested in international markets? So as a rule of thumb, I would say maybe 10 to 15% can be invested. But I would certainly like to add here that if you're a new investor, if you're a small investor in the process of building your portfolio, maybe international funds are not for you, because there are not many options available to you to diversify the portfolio within the domestic market. But if you're an experienced investor, you have built a decent size of portfolio, I think you can start looking at investing in international markets. So like I said, a rule of thumb, 10 to 15% can go. So once you decide how much allocation, then the key decision that has to be taken is what kind of markets, what kind of fund you should be investing in. Like I said, there are funds which are investing in US markets, China market, or Brazil or regions or commodities. Again, it depends on what is your understanding or what is your expectation from that region or a type of company that this fund is investing in. For example, if you look at US markets, the US markets have been doing very well over the last few years, but I think there is still a case for investing some money in the US market. So these are few factors that one has to look at before deciding where the money should go.
Could there be any risks as well when such a kind of investment is involved, because you are exposing yourself not only to local risks and local threats, but across the globe a lot keeps happening at the same time. So how to keep track, and what could be the risks, more importantly, that one should be prepared for?
Well, you know, like with any investment, obviously there are risks. Even though we talked about achieving higher level of diversification, there are certainly risks when you invest in the global markets. For example, there are geopolitical issues. So there are big geopolitical issues involving different countries, different regions, clearly, and they are widely discussed, debated, publicized. So they can have impact on the performance of the global funds. So clearly, even if you are going in the economies which are, you know, uncorrelated with yours, still the risk which are, you know, associated with that particular economy, you still have to kind of face them. So clearly there can be a risk in terms of, like I said, geopolitical issues or other risks which are there. The second is, I think if you look at from taxation point of view, anyone who is investing in international funds has to understand that the taxation is very different from the domestic fund. For example, it's the debt fund, you know, taxation which is, you know, applicable to these kind of funds. So there is some kind of risk over there. And third is, if your domestic currency appreciates, then I think you can lose some of the return that you earn over a period of time.
So many mutual fund advisors also suggest that international funds to equity investors, because international investing nullifies country-specific risks like a DMO or a budget, GST, etc. But that means that they are not entirely isolated or insulated, rather, to risks abroad, right?
No, of course, the risks are there. See, the point is, there are certain risks which happen in the domestic economy, as you mentioned about some of them. Now, that may not be the issue in those economies. Like I mentioned right at the beginning, you know, you may be investing, for example, at times in our economy, the fiscal deficit can be an issue. But when you're investing in an economy where the fiscal deficit is low or the current account, you know, so there's a surplus in there. So I think then you're talking about different market. But yes, of course, you are investing in, let's say, asset class like equity, for example. The risk associated with the asset class, the risk associated with international investing will always be there. But look at the other side of it. I mean, you know, you can actually hedge your portfolio when you invest in, you know, international markets. Now, for example, look at someone whose children are planning to study abroad, let's say from 7 or 10 years from now. Now, you want to hedge, you know, the money that you're going to be spending after 7-10 years in terms of rupee depreciation. So you can start investing in the international markets, or let's say you're investing in US markets. So because you're investing and you're also getting benefit of the rupee depreciation there, you kind of hedge your investing and you're also getting benefit of the rupee depreciation there. You kind of hedge your investment or even your portfolio, which, you know. So I think there are advantages, and like any investment, there are pros and cons of investing. That's why I said, I think it's very important for someone to be fully aware of the risk and the benefit that can come before, you know, putting the money in there. Because many a times, you know, international investing is considered as like, you know, glamour, saying, okay, I'm investing in international market, but that shouldn't be the case. I think one has to really understand what to expect and what not to expect from international investing.
Just to sum it up, the entire conversation we've had, if someone were to have international funds or wants to be exposed to international stocks in via mutual funds, ideally how much should the exposure be, at least in the initial few months?
Well, you know, like I said, the rule of thumb says it should be around 10-15%, but obviously it depends on the kind of investor you are, what is your time horizon, what is your goal. Like I mentioned about someone who wants to build a corpus for child education abroad, that, you know, can vary depending on how much money he wants to accumulate. So clearly it will depend on one's personal situation, but like I said, broadly, 10-15% can invest it, but invest it over a period of time. It can't be done straight away, because any investment that you make in equity market, wherever, it has to be done in a phased manner, should not be invested in one go.
Mr. Rustagi, I think it's time now to get in some viewer queries as well. We have an email from Kevin Deesa. He's 45 years old and he would like to invest in few mutual funds. His aim is to garner 10 crore rupees of corpus over the next 15 years. So he wants you to suggest his name. He hasn't given out clearly his budget, but his target is very clear, 10 crores for 15 years. He also wants to know if HDFC and SBI hybrid equity funds are a good bet for investing at the current juncture. What would be your advice to him?
Well, you know, it always helps when you have a target in mind and a time horizon, clear time horizon in mind. In this case, he's looking to build a corpus of around 10 crore over a 15-year period. So clearly, when you're investing for such a long period, you have to invest in an asset class that has the potential to provide real rate of return to you, positive real rate of return, which is what equity can do. So my recommendation would be to look at investing in equity funds through SIP. If I assume annualized return of 12%, to achieve his target of 10 crore over the next 15 years, he has to invest 2 lakh rupees per month. It's always very important to, one, invest in the right asset class and also create the right balance between risk and reward within that asset class. So my recommendation would be that he should be looking at building a portfolio which provides the right balance in terms of exposure to large cap, mid cap and small cap. So I'm recommending 5 funds where he can invest 40,000 each. So I'll begin with Kotak Standard Multicap, which is a multicap fund you can look at. SBI Focus, again, a multicap slightly having bias towards the large cap right now. Then Mirae Asset Emerging Blue Chip Fund, which invests 50% each in large and mid. So these are few funds that he can invest and build his corpus over a period of time. It's very important for him to continue investing irrespective of what happens in the market, because there will be times which will be very challenging, but you have to continue. And a couple of funds I would like to add here, like Axis 25 Focus Fund, which is again a quality fund, and Motilal 30. So these are, that's a mid-cap fund. So these 5 funds, 40,000 each, he can invest and build this corpus of 10 crore. And he also mentioned about 2 hybrid funds. Well, you know, if I have to choose one out of 2 hybrid funds that he mentioned, I would prefer SBI Equity Hybrid Fund. But my advice is that because your time horizon is 15 years, the hybrid fund, because it invests around 30-35% in debt, may not be the great idea to invest over a period of 15 years.
Okay. All right. Next email then. Gaurav Malhotra writes to us and he wants his portfolio to be reviewed. He is investing right now. He's listed out a few funds actually: SBI Hybrid Equity Fund, HDFC Small Cap Fund, SBI Blue Chip Fund, Mirae India Asset Equity Fund, Mirae India Emerging Blue Chip Fund, and also IDFC Multicap Fund. Out of these names, IDFC Multicap Fund is yielding low returns for the last 5 years, he says. He also says there's a one-time investment made in HDFC Small Cap Fund a year ago, which is also right now incurring losses. Wants to ask if he should rejig his investments. He wants to retire in the next 15 years with a corpus of 5 crore rupees. Given that 2 of his funds are not doing well right now, what would be your advice? Should he take a relook and perhaps try to shift his money elsewhere?
But let's begin with talking about his target. You know, he has a time horizon again of 15 years, which is, like we said in the earlier case also, I think investing in equity fund through SIP is a great idea, which is what exactly he's doing. His target is 5 crores, so he should be investing around 1 lakh rupees per month to get there. Now, if you look at his portfolio, a couple of changes I would recommend surely. You know, he's investing in SBI Blue Chip Fund. My advice would be, I mentioned about this fund from SBI Focus Equity Fund. I think that will be a better option. And like I said earlier, hybrid fund, SBI hybrid fund, one of the best performing hybrid fund today, but since your time horizon is 15 years, may not be a great idea to invest in that. He also mentioned about IDFC Multicap, which has not done well. It is true that this fund has not done so well, but we need to understand, analyze the reason why this fund has not done well. It's a quality fund, by the way. What has happened to this fund has remained true to label. For example, Multicap fund should have decent size of exposure to all 3 segments. Now what has happened is many multicap funds in the last couple of years have actually increased their exposure to large cap to the extent of 80-90%, and even so because the large caps in a very focused manner were doing well in the last 2 years, all those funds have performed much better than IDFC. But the fact is that When the situation turned around and the market become more broad-based, the broad-based portfolio should do well. So, you know, my advice would be that having gone through this period of, you know, I would say lower performance as compared to the peer group over the last 2 years, I think he should continue investing in that. I'm sure as the market becomes more broad-based, this fund will start performing well. And as I mentioned earlier, the portfolio is a good quality portfolio.
Okay, all right then. Next and final query for the day. This is also an email. Jitesh Nayak writes to us. He says he has SIPs in the following funds since February 2018. So it's been 2 years since he invested 6,000 rupees in Kotak Select Focus, 6,000 rupees in Mirae Asset India Opportunities Large Cap Fund. Motilal Oswal Most Focus 35 is also on the list. AB Sun Life Advantage Multi Cap Fund. Canara Robeco Emerging Equities. 3,000 goes there. Another 3,000 in Mirae Emerging Blue Chip Mid Cap. And 2,000 rupees. Go into L&T Emerging Business Small Cap Fund. So this is the portfolio he's been holding for 2 years now. All the investments are made for the next 10 years, he says. His purpose is his daughter's education, marriage and his own retirement. Please advise whether his portfolio is fine or if he should make any changes to it. That's his ultimate query, and the goals also have been clearly defined. Of course, the corpus he has not mentioned yet, what he targets to achieve. But going by his investments, what is your verdict?
Well, broadly, I would say the portfolio is good. But I think there's certainly a case for reducing the number of funds, looking at the overall investment amount that he is investing per month. So a couple of funds I would recommend that you should exit. ABSL Advantage Fund. Is one fund I believe that he should exit from there. And second is L&T Emerging Fund. And I believe that the amount which is being invested in these two should be added to the remaining funds in the portfolio. I think it's important to have a portfolio which is not overly diversified. So I think because that when you have an over-diversified portfolio, that actually creates problem in terms of monitoring, and then it doesn't benefit in any way. So I think exit from these two funds, reallocate this amount to existing fund, and I think he should be fine.
There you have it. That's the verdict coming in from Mr. Rustagi on your portfolio. Hope Mr. Nayak is taking note, and so are the other viewers who have similar goals and who want to attain a certain corpus and or have already invested in some of these funds listed out by some of our viewer queries, as well as the ones mentioned by our expert. Mr. Rustagi, it was great chatting with you today. Thank you so much for taking time out, for talking to us about investing in international markets via mutual funds, and for helping our viewers out as well. Thank you. All right. With that, we're going to slip into a short break here. Plenty lined up when we come back. Stay tuned.